The first season is based on The Elfstones of Shannara, which is the second book. So, and it's the entire book. Yeah.
And this is a series that's close to 4 years in the making since the first book came out. How did it finally end up here at MTG with you guys?
Well, we read it. It was sort of brought to our attention about 2.5 years ago. Mm-hmm. And we were familiar with Terry because he had another book called Magic Kingdom for Sale, which we flirted with when it was at Universal as a movie. But we read the book and thought it was, you know, an amazing story, you know, with a great ending and a wonderful kind of love triangle in the middle, which is something you don't usually see in fantasy books. And we also liked the idea that it was our world thousands of years in the future, so it wasn't, like, you know...
So it's a fantasy story, but also the science fiction element.
Yeah.
It's always as creators and showrunners, you're looking for something that's not on television, that's something different, that isn't following, but is leading, and for us it's felt like something very, very different.
Are you attracted to epic sagas in general?
I would say yes, we clearly are.
Yeah. Based on the last race.
Yeah.
Well, it felt, for us it felt very, and it's Smallville was similar in that it was taking something that had been before and reinventing it and making it our own. And with this one, with Terry's blessing, we certainly have taken the material and it's very true to itself, but it's also very different from the book. So it felt like it could become its original thing. Because the book's 30 years old, so it felt like it needed some contemporization and making it feel that it had a point of view about today's world.
But
the best science fiction always talks about today, and I think we've found a way to do that in this series.
Why New Zealand? Why did you bring the series to New Zealand?
Well, it was, there were a couple sort of reasons, sort of creative and practical. You know, we knew sort of in the schedule of when we were going to shoot it, we were going to be shooting it in January. January in New Zealand is the middle of summer. So, but then I think creatively, it actually gives you the sort of landscapes that you want for a fantasy series.
Because it feels like our world, but also feels completely different.
Yeah.
It feels like you're in, primeval forests and amazing beach locations, mountains. It's just like epic. And it felt like perfect for what we wanted to do. Another thing New Zealand has, it has a legacy of fantasy. So you have the people who built the sets, who designed the costumes, who made the props, all of that. And the legacy actually started with Hercules and Xena, went into The Lord of the Rings, The Hobbit, and Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe, and that expertise is nowhere else. So the level of detail we have on our sets and our wardrobe and our props is like second to none. It's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Talk about your production quality, because I saw the trailer today. It really does look movie quality
amazing.
How did you get that level and budget?
Well, it's certainly, I think, one of the big, if not the biggest show that MTV's ever launched. And it's part of a straight to series, so we had that luxury. And we had the time to in pre-production. But also we demanded that we get movie quality effects. There's people who did visual effects, that built our cities, did the effects for Game of Thrones. So we
also use Weta Workshop because it's a mix of CG. Like, there's obviously a bunch of CG in the show, but it's not complete CG environments or complete CG sets. Like, the sets are real, but everything is sort of enhanced. But
we wanted it to feel like Star Wars.
Yeah,
so it has a lot of it feels like Star Wars more than it does Lord of the Rings.
Right,
that's our aims. It's a mix of aesthetics. There's some CG, but it does feel real. And that was a deliberate choice. The sets, it's a beautiful, practical set, but an epic scale. There's some CG enhancement, but it's not like it's, Once Upon a Time, which is a fully CG environment. It can feel a little animated and takes you out, bounces you out.
Has Terry concluded the novel series?
Has Terry done what?
I don't think he has, no.
Okay, so could you potentially face a Game of Thrones situation where you've caught up to the books?
We couldn't, because the books are told actually generationally, and there are 26 of them already.
We should be so lucky.
We should be so lucky. So, he's been doing this for 40 years and he writes a book a year.
Well, so the segment that you're focusing on is...
What's that?
The segment you're focusing on is fine.
Maybe not. So we've been talking to Terry about how we would do that.
Yeah.
How we would sort of go forward. So.
Can you give viewers that aren't familiar with the series already some teasers about the relationships and the characters that they'll be meeting?
Sure. It's
So yeah, I mean
the
Elfstones. The series really follows the epic quest of three young people: Will, Amberlee, and Eritrea. Will is a half elf, half human. Amberlee is a elven princess, and Eritrea is a human called a Rova, and she's more like a gypsy. And it's they, through a series of circumstances, have to go on an epic quest to save the world. And at the center of this quest is a elven tree called the Elkries. And the Elkries was created tens of thousands of years ago to protect the world from an army of demons. And the tree starts to die. Each leaf represents a single demon. And in the beginning of the story, the tree starts to die, and the demons start being released one by one. And the heroes have to go and get a new seed and bring it back to the elven capital, and the tree has to be reborn.
While it's dying, more demons are coming out. They're on a quest. So you've got sort of the young people on a quest, and then back at the castle, you have John Custodes and his sons and Alanon the Druid all trying to, like,
so it's multi-generation in that way.
Yeah.